Well, good morning and welcome into worship. We're delighted to have you with us today. My name is David Willis. It's my privilege to be the pastor here at Forest Park. You have stumbled in either quite innocently or quite purposefully into our contemporary worship service. And it, once again, is an honor to have you here today, whether you are right here or whether you are watching online. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Hey, if you are watching online and you say, I would love to have a bulletin, let me invite you to go to our webpage, www.fpumc.org. You can navigate to the bottom of that page. You'll find right there a PDF file of our bulletin, and you can have one and read along with us today. Two things in your bulletin I want to point out to you today. One is this, it's a connection card. That separates from your bulletin. That helps us keep track of your visit with us today, a way for you to communicate with me on the back. Good news about this, our own Corey is developing an app for Forest Park. What's going to happen when that app gets up and running? A bunch of different things. You're going to be able to tithe through that, give your tithes and your offerings through that app. You're going to be able to check your children in when they show up for kids' activities, and you're going to be able, through that app on your smartphone, to log in when you get here. You're just going to be able to tap that button, and it's that easy, right? Just tapping a button.
Yes, and it's also going to be live streamed to the app, so you no longer have to go through Facebook. You can go straight to the app.
Yep, go to the app and watch us here. You don't have to worry about whether Facebook is unstable today. Not that it's stable any day, but that it's unstable today or not. So connection cards are still going to be around, but hopefully they will become a thing of the past. Also in your bulletin today is a little announcement that looks like this. You should have gotten one of those when you came in. It's Fifth Sunday Games and Giving. FE Kids is starting a new tradition on Fifth Sundays. We're going to have games and community service, a community service project during Sunday school and children's church every fifth Sunday. In October, we're going to be collecting items to create toiletry bags for Anchorage Children's Home in Heidel House. That's going to be coming up on... We're going to be collecting those items until Sunday, October 24th. And that will be... Look at that. That's on Halloween. Can I say Halloween from the pulpit? Okay. Halloween. It's going to be on Halloween, October 31st. Couple of other announcements. Where's Tom Upton? Tom Upton. There's Tom right there. Hey, stand up. Everybody look at Tom. Wave, Tom. Tom. Say. All right. Bless you. Bless you, bless you, brother. Bless you, Tom. Tom was supposed to be joining our church today. But no, he is. Tom's coming to join us, coming into membership at Forest Park from Woodlawn Church. We're glad to have Tom. Be sure that you pat him on the back and say hey and welcome. Been with us for a while. We're glad to have him as a member. A couple of other announcements I want to point out. Wednesday night dinner is going to be beef stroganoff and all the fixins. Women's ministry announcements on the back. Ladies Fall Retreat coming up October 21st through the 24th. And some new giving information on the back, which is of interest because we've only got 3 months left in the year. And if you do the math there, let me just encourage you to evaluate your giving up to this point. How about that? Let me just leave it at that. Take a look at your giving. Take a look at those figures. And let's see if we can get there this year. We would love and appreciate any and all gifts you could share with us. As you leave today, be sure that you drop your tithes and your offerings in one of our white offering baskets and drop also your connection card in there as well. Don't forget anything. Okay, very good. You looked... Okay, everyone. Very good. Let's open with a word of prayer. God, thank you for being with us today. We depend upon your presence to redeem this time. We come to you today acknowledging that we have failed to love you with our whole heart. Oh, a communion liturgy says that, Lord. We have not heard the cry of the needy. We have not heard, we have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. And the liturgy goes on to say, free us for joyful obedience. I love that. I get stuck on that. Free us, Father, for joyful obedience so that we can go outside the walls of the church and be your church. Doesn't matter whether we're gay or straight. Doesn't matter whether we're Republican or Democrat. Doesn't matter where we're black or white. What matters, Father, is that we are engaged in loving you. And we're doing your work. You'll take care of the rest. Okay? If we're Republican and we need to be Democrat, I full well, Father, you'll take care of that and vice versa. If we're sinful and we need to cut it out, then you'll take care of that. We know we are, and we know we do. Today, we come to worship you, to be reminded of who you say we are, not who we say we are. To be reminded of who you say we are, not who the world tells us we are. We come today to be set free. We come today to be revived, to do your work in this place. Bless this time of worship that we have. Inhabit our worship and praise. Open our hearts and our minds to your presence this day. And as we worship, may we feel your presence. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, stand up if you want to. Sit down if you want to. If you get tired of standing up, you can sit down. If you get tired of sitting down, you can stand up. Worship with us. Thanks for being here today.
Blooming red in the drought.
Y'all know this one. Sing with me.
There's a quenching rain in the wings of the gathering clouds. Lift your eyes and look to the horizon now. There's still a hope for us. Reach up from the dust and call it down. Can you hear? Sky spills over. Oh, oh.
Tell you how good my God is. You guys know God's good, right? God's so good. But we don't always get, or at least for me, I have these moments of our life of provision and faithfulness. But let me tell you a sweet encounter I had with God 2 weeks ago. So I told you guys about the funeral, and God has really just been stretching me to like step out and do more things that are scary to me. So I was asked to speak somewhere in town here. And it was with a group of moms, young group of moms, and I was super confident, and I was so excited for the opportunity. And I thought, okay, God, this is awesome. I'm gonna do it, I'm gonna step out. I don't have Kelly to hide behind, so that's scary, but I'm gonna step out. So I thought I gave him control. So then I went to one of my friends, I said, hey, will you go with me? And she said, I'm so sorry. She's a night shift worker, nurse, and couldn't go. Had to sleep the next day. I was like, dang it. Okay. So I went to Jamie. I'm like, Jamie, you want to go with me? Great networking opportunity, right? Like, solid justification. And Jamie said, I'm so sorry. I volunteer in Jackson's class, or I would totally be there with you. And God said, stop. Stop asking. You have me. That's all you need. And for those of you who don't know, I don't really go anywhere by myself. It's just freaks me out. I have the convenience of a mama and people here, so I very rarely go places by myself. Little fear of mine. So this was really scary, really, really scary to me. But I thought, okay, God, I dropped Olivia off. I went over to First Baptist, and I thought, okay, God, I'm doing this, and all I need is you. All I need is you. But give me strength, because I was so, so scared. I get there. First Baptist is so like overwhelmingly large, and so I parked in some poor sweet old lady's spot, and I got out and I just found somebody because I was seeing these sweet mamas walk in, and I get in this atrium and I'm looking around hoping I can find where in the world I'm supposed to go, and I turn and a girl from Bible study named Stephanie showed up out of nowhere, and I was like, what are you doing here? She's like, I've known I was coming for 2 weeks, but I wasn't supposed to tell you. I was like, well, if you did, I wouldn't be so nervous. But I know what God did. God asked me to step out and challenged me to only rely on him in that moment. But then what did my God do? He showed up and gave me my heart's desire, which was to have somebody there with me. He did not have to do that. I didn't expect him to do that. And honestly, I was so scared and so stretched by stepping out. When I saw her, it was like starving or thirsting to death and getting a gulp of water. I mean, it was that profound to me to see somebody that I knew there. So I wanted to tell you guys that because, like I said, we stand up here and we're like, my God's faithful. He's so good. And he's all of those things. But what my God also is, he loves you. He wants to give you these desires of your heart. Like, he desires for you to enjoy this life. And so I hope that encourages you, because sometimes we hear nothing from him. We go through seasons of just nothing. We feel. But don't trust your feelings, because he is here with us right now. He is here in this room. He's going to leave with you, and he's going to go with you as you face any challenges that you face this week. Let's continue to challenge ourselves to lay aside the things of the world and to come into this building to remember what this worship experience is about. It is not about what we look like in this room. It is not about how perfect our sound is. It's not about any of that. Our Father wants us, his bride, to go out with him, to meet him in this place. He desires to meet with us. So let's just give him all the honor and glory. And remember, speaking of myself, remember what it's all about.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart, and I'm coming back to you. You deserve.
Pastor Willis, I am under the distinct impression that you can take the rest of the day off.
The rest of the day off, very good.
Because she has handled it for you.
She has. Let's just have the benediction. But not before the offering.
But not before the offering. Y'all pray with me, please. Father God, we are thankful for this day. We are thankful to gather here as a family of believers. We are thankful to have people back among us that have been gone. Thank you, Jesus, for the blessing of healing. Thank you for loving us and truly wanting us to be happy in this life while always looking forward to you. God, I pray that you will bless the tithes and the offerings that are given today. Help to guide our church in how they are spent, how they are used. And Lord, help us to remember that every penny is meant for nothing else but to bring glory to you. It is all about you. Lord, we love you. We lift this prayer in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
And I hear you call. for the one who gave me life. Nothing is a sacrifice. Use me how you want to.
Outstanding time in worship. Thank you to the praise team. Hey, about 30 of us gathered here yesterday and made ourselves available, and my body feels it today. I'm not going to lie to you. I'm a little bit sore. Thank you to those who showed up and helped yesterday. Thank you for your prayers. If you weren't able to make it, we're grateful that you lifted us up in prayer. Thank you to Corey for posting things on Facebook for us. We had a great time. We had a time yesterday, let's put it that way. I want to tell you what, there was some of the work that we did that was not easy, but a big thank you to the Averitts and Redmond bringing all their equipment stuff in and helping. Thank you to those who pulled weeds, those who masked off the hall to do some painting, and just got a lot of things accomplished yesterday. Fantastic, fantastic time together. And I'm very, very grateful to those who gave of their time yesterday. And there will be other opportunities. I guarantee you there are some things that we need to get accomplished here at the church that we can only do with your sweat equity. And we will be seeking you out again in the future. It's time for children's bread. If the kids will come on down. Where are the kids? No children. Oh, that's right. It's Communion Sunday. They're going out. All right. I was all geeked up to do children's bread. There they go. Going to the bat. No, hey, Lyndon. Oh, right down there, buddy. No children's bread today. Right down here, sweetie. Go that straight down the middle of the aisle right there. There you go. They're calling you. Man, I dig those boots. You are ready for the rain today. Look at that. He ready for the rain, and then he's going to go frog gigging afterwards. He is ready. Lyndon is always ready. If you've never met Lyndon before, that dude, he is always ready. Love that boy. Love them all. Fantastic time in worship today, and we continue on today talking about our sermon series, right? Questions, questions, questions. We're talking about how it is that we answer these God-sized questions, and we concluded that the way we answer God-sized questions is straightforward, and that's exactly the way that Peter answered Jesus as we consider the scripture that we're going to share in just a few moments. It's become in vogue of late in movie town, Tinseltown, Hollywood. It's become in vogue in the movies to kind of give a teaser at the end of movies, right? As the credits roll, there will sometimes be a blooper reel that they'll play. Sometimes they will tease an upcoming movie that continues on with that. So, but the genre that seems to have that perfected is the superhero movie, right? The Marvel Enterprise, etc., etc. And the one that I think of is that the I don't even know how to describe this. The first of the latest Star Wars, which is actually the beginning of the end. Is that right? I don't know. But you remember at the end of that first one, who do we see cloaked, and he's standing there on this hill over the ocean? Well, it's Luke Skywalker. So, hey, we get some kind of idea of what's going on. Hollywood's perfected that, but they're not the first ones that have ever used that. As we look at the scripture that we're going to share today, we're going to get a little teaser, a little Easter egg. You know, that's what Hollywood calls it, right? It's an Easter egg. They put hidden things inside these movies so that you can know what's coming later and get you all geeked up and ready for the next movie. Today, we got Jesus, and he's taken his disciples, and they've sailed across a little bit of the ocean, and they've gone to, or the sea, I should say, and they've gone to this place called Caesarea Philippi. And he gets them out of the boat, and it's just Jesus and them, and they're standing there together, and that's where we pick up. We're going to be reading today of the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew chapter 16. Picking up in verse 13. If you've got your Bibles, you can turn there now, Matthew 16, 13. Or you can look up on the screen. Philip, are the words going to pop up on the screen? No, he says, they're not going to pop up on the screen. So this is what you can do. You got a choice. You can open your Bible. You can grab that cell phone, and you can read along with me. Or you can just sit back and listen as I share the Word of God with you. Remember where we are. It's going to remind us. We are on the shores of Caesarea Philippi. And we're going to be dealing with a question today that may be one of the most important questions that you ever deal with. Matthew 16, 13 through 20, out of the New International Version, they read like this. When the disciples came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, Jesus asked them, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" Let me stop right there. Jesus has his disciples together, and he says, okay, you all aren't with me all the time. You hear other people talk. So who do people say that I am? What's the word on the street? What are people saying about me? Who am I? Well, the disciples aren't caught off guard. They answer immediately. Some say John the Baptist, who we know had been beheaded. Others say Elijah, a prophet long dead. And still others say Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets, if you will. And they're not wrong. Okay. They're correct, because they're hitting right around the truth. Jesus is not something out of the ordinary for God. It is his coming, something different for God, because he's about to begin to deal with you and with me in a different way. So he's hitting right at the point. The disciples are hitting right at the point. This is who people are saying you are, and they're not far off the mark. But there is a distinct difference. And Jesus is searching for that distinct difference. And so he asks a couple of questions, the second one that will be most important. But what about you? He asked, and here it is. Who do you say I am? Now that's the God-sized question to end all God-sized questions. What about you? Who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah, and they lived happily ever after, right? Negatory. That's not the way things went down. As a matter of fact, we know the truth. We know that at this particular point, at this particular confession, the contest begins. Well, the contest continues in a different way because the contest had begun a long time ago back in Genesis. You see, back in Genesis, we have the origin of sin. We've got Adam and Eve, and we know that they substitute themselves in God's place. That's really what they did. That's the essence of original sin. We want to be the God of our own life. And so Satan begins to trip Adam and Eve up by asking Eve, did God really say? And Eve falls for it. Eve wants to know. Eve is after knowledge. And Eve drags Adam into it. And Adam comes quite willingly. And forever and ever, our DNA is altered. Forever and ever after that, everyone who was ever born was born in original sin. There's a contest. Right? That's when the contest started. Here, Jesus asked the question, what about you? Okay, you told me what other people think. What about you? Who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you're the Messiah. You're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, you're exactly right. But don't tell anybody. And then immediately, as Jesus begins to tell what's about to happen to him, the Son of Man is going to go into Jerusalem. He's going to be betrayed into the hands of men, and he's going to be crucified. And third day, he's going to rise again. Immediately, Peter pulls him aside and says, never, Lord, that's not going to happen. And this confessor is rebuked. Get thee behind me, Satan, is the way the King James Version says that Jesus addressed Peter. So immediately we move into this confession, and moving into this confession, we're reminded of the contest. What is the contest? Well, the contest harkens back to Genesis, and the contest is between the truth of who God is and our flesh. The contest is between the truth of who God is in the person of Jesus Christ and your flesh and my flesh. And what have we just established about your flesh and my flesh? We've established the fact that our flesh is tainted and there's nothing we can do about it. We've discussed this before. One of the things you learn taking psychology, abnormal psychology, is the struggle or the difference of opinion that exist in realms of psychology that center around nature versus nurture, right? Okay, it's nature. The kid is bad because of nature, or the kid is bad because he's been exposed to bad. She's bad because she was born that way. She's bad because she was raised that way. There's the concept of tabula rasa, right? The children come a blank slate, and they're very impressionable. And the truth is, there's a balance between the two. But what is that side of the balance that says they're like that because of nature? Well, that side is original sin. Hey, there's something that exists in you. There's something that exists in me that's there, and we can't do anything about it. And that is our flesh. And this is where the contest comes in. Because God's will is often contrary to the will of our flesh. The flesh wants what the flesh wants, and the flesh wants what the flesh wants right now. It's plain and simple. There's no wiggle room there. It is what it is. You know, I said a while ago as I was praying, be what God has made you to be. Don't be what the world tells you that you are. Don't be what you say you are. There's a whole world around us that is content to be identified by the world. There's a whole world around us that is content in identifying themselves when the true word of God tells us that we are His. The true word of God tells us that we are His creation. And yet we're content to take on the identity of the world. the contest between the will of our flesh and the truth of who God is. It sounds hopeless because, let's be frank, a lot of times when this battle rages within you and within me, what's going to win? Well, our flesh is going to win. So what's the point? Well, the point is this. Jesus told us through his word, he told his disciples that I'm not going to leave you by yourself. I'm not going to leave you alone to fight this battle. As a matter of fact, when I go, the Heavenly Father is going to send the counselor. And automatically, the weight of God, the truth of who he is, comes down on our side. We know it is the Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit that descended upon Jesus when he rose from the water, when he was baptized by John the Baptist, the same Holy Spirit that fell over the group of people who did not speak the same language, and suddenly they began to speak in different languages so that everyone understood what was being said about the truth of who God is. It's the same Holy Spirit that lives within you if you are saved, if you've been converted, if you've had a conversion, whatever you want to call it. If you have put your faith in Jesus Christ, if you have put your faith in the confession, then the Holy Spirit lives in you, and the Holy Spirit is the counselor. And so now, with the confession, comes the contest, and we're blessed by the counselor. But confession, folks, that's not enough. The truth is, anybody can make the confession that Peter made. You can make the confession. I can make the confession. Anybody can say Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. But if you have no faith in that truth, then it's inconsequential. It means nothing. You can spout truth as information, or you can spout the truth of God and know that it's true in your heart. And that is when the counselor helps fight the battle. Jesus knew what was coming. Jesus understood what was about to take place. And that's why we come to the communion table. That's why we have an open communion table in the United Methodist Church. We have an open communion table. That means it doesn't matter what faith tradition you are. If you love God, if you earnestly repent of your sin, and you seek to live at peace with your neighbor, then this table is open to you because it's not our table, it's God's table. You love God, seek to live at peace with your neighbor, earnestly repent of your sin. Hey, that horrible little wafer that you've got in the plastic and that nasty little grape juice that you've got in that cup, that's for you. But it's not going to stay that way. Because you see, something amazing is about to happen. I'm going to pray over the bread and the wine. And it's not going to transform into the body of Jesus Christ, but it's going to become representative of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. And in its taking, we are going to experience fellowship with one another. We are going to experience fellowship with God. And we are going to be reminded that the contest, though it rages until we draw our last breath here on earth and open our eyes in heaven, the contest is skewed in our favor. Because the confession leads to contest, but the counselor is on our side, and the counselor is the very presence of God with us here and now. Jesus knew what was about to happen. That's why when you read on past verse 20 that we shared today, that's why Jesus rebukes Peter. It is the contest that leads Peter to say, hey, it's not going to be like that. You understand that? It's Peter's flesh that does not want things to go down the way Jesus said they're going to go down. It is the contest. And Jesus stops him because he knows what's about to happen. In a little while, after you read through the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of Luke and John and Mark, you get to the point where Jesus knows it's coming to an end. And he tells them, we're about to go up to Jerusalem and we're going to celebrate the Passover. Everybody remember what the Passover is? It was both a dark time and a wondrous time in the history of Israel. The Passover was the last part of the story of the Israelites being released from Israel. You remember the plagues had come. There had been 9 plagues. Finally, after Pharaoh had refused to let the Israelites go from Egypt, finally God says to Moses, tell the Israelites, take a perfect lamb, slaughter that lamb, spread the blood over the door, because tonight the death angel is coming. And when the death angel comes and it gets to your house and it sees the blood of the perfect lamb spread over the door, it will pass you over. But if that is not on the door, woe unto you, because there's going to be a reckoning in those households. There's going to be a reckoning in those barnyards. There's going to be a reckoning. And it happened. The death angel comes. The Egyptians awake in the morning to find death. And Pharaoh says, go. And the Egyptians are so glad to get rid of the Israelites. Not only do they say, get out, they say, here, take the best of what we've got. So they leave not only with their freedom, they leave rich. That's the way God leaves me and you. You see, when we experience death in that way, we call it baptism. The old person goes into the water. The old person goes under the water. You know, because I'm an equal opportunity baptizer, I don't care how you want to be baptized. I'll sprinkle you, dunk you, or pour you. I don't care. When you go under the water, the old person dies and the new comes to life. And when you rise up, what are you? You are free and you are rich. You may not be rich in your bank account, but you are rich in eternity because you're rich in life. Because the old person has passed away and the new person has come to life. And that justifying grace that we experience when we know the forgiveness of sins, that justifying grace that we experience that cleanses us, suddenly has a concrete example. Death rising to life in richness and freedom. And then it's happily ever after, right? No. No. The contest gets harder. Because before, Satan had you where he wanted you. Now he knows that he's going to have to up the game because the contest really starts. And he knows how the contest is going to end. So Jesus says, go up to Jerusalem, we're going to celebrate the Passover meal, and that's what they do. And at the end of the Seder meal, Jesus does something that's completely and totally mind-blowing. You got your little communion cup things? Anybody need one? Because we're about to get serious. Anybody need one? Okay, here we go. Jesus does something that is, listen, it's far out. Okay? Supper's over. Jesus takes a loaf of bread. Hold on, don't eat yet. And he lifts the bread, and he breaks the bread, and he asks the Lord to bless it. Don't eat yet. I'll tell you when. He says, take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this as often as you do it in remembrance of me. So they did. Jesus then took a cup of wine. Kind of did the same thing, except he didn't break it. Don't drink yet. He says, ask the Lord to bless it as he lifts it up. He passes it to his disciples, and he said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And the question comes full circle. And the answer is realized. What about you? Who do you say I am? You are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. But they still didn't understand. It would take Easter before they understood. And then there was a little learning curve. But they would get it right. And they would participate in the splitting of time in two. So that's what we do today. We come answering the question, what about you? Who do you say I am? We come not just to answering the question from an empirical standpoint. We come answering the question from a faith standpoint. It's not only that you know who Jesus is, do you have faith in who Jesus is? It's not only can you quantify who he is, can you qualify who he is, but is his identity internalized? And do you believe the totality of who he is and what he's done? And so as we take these elements today, we answer the question. Heavenly Father, pour out your Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may go into the world to be the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Forgive us of the sins that we have committed. We have not loved the church. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us. Free us for joyful obedience. And Father, as we take these elements, may we be reminded that in fellowship with you and with each other, we are revived to live out the truth of the confession, to never give up on the contest, and to rely on the counselor to reveal to us again and again the truth of your identity and to deepen our faith as we traverse this time apart from you. We ask these things in the precious name of God's Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so, as Jesus did, I remind you that this is the body of Christ broken for you. Now take and eat. And just as Jesus did, I remind you that this cup is his blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Now take and drink. It is indeed a poignant question. What about you? What do you say that I am? If you're here today and you're struggling with answering that, maybe you can answer it from a historical standpoint, but you fail to ever answer it from a faith standpoint. I want you to know that now is your time. I want you to know that you're not here, that you're not watching online, that you're not listening by happenstance. I want you to know that the sin that you're carrying with you has a great price to be paid. And that if you die in that sin, you risk eternity separated from God. But I want you to know that the contest is cured by the confession and finalized by the counselor. And I want you to remember that though we know how the party ends, longing for the end of the party is not the purpose. That's a fancy way of saying this, or a not so way a fancy way of saying what I say to you so often. The purpose of your salvation, the purpose of my salvation, is not that we get to go to heaven. That's the byproduct. The purpose of our salvation is that we get to come alongside other people, and we get to say, we know that you're in a battle and that you're in a contest. Hear this confession and meet my wonderful counselor that will be with you and that will battle with you and that will tip the scales in your favor. That's the purpose of salvation, that others understand the truth and the depth of love that Christ has for us. As we close out worship today, I know people are asking, are we ever going to come back to the altar for communion again? Are we ever going to pass the offering plate again? And I'll tell you this, like I told them in the early service, every Sunday that we gather for communion and have to eat those terrible little wafers, we are one Sunday closer to coming back to the altar. Every Sunday that we gather and we don't pass the offering plate, we are one Sunday closer to being able to pass the offering plate again. And yeah, you can clap if you want to. It's fine. But let me be honest with you about something. I've said from the get-go that I would like this church to be part of the solution and not part of the problem. Let me tell you what I'm tired of. I'm tired of people being sick and needing pastoral care and not being able to get into the hospital to see them. I'm tired of people dying absent from spiritual care. I'm tired of not knowing whether people want me in their house as their pastor or not, and I'm tired of having to wonder if I'm going to cross-contaminate some of you simply by shaking your hand. So until we can be a little bit more sure, I ask for your patience. We'll get there. It's just going to be a bit. If I die here while I'm your pastor, that's going to be the epitaph on my headstone. It's going to be a while, but it's just going to be a bit. Because we started out saying it about Hurricane Michael, didn't we? Now we're saying it about Hurricane Michael and COVID. Until we get there, hold on. But until we can gather at the altar again, I want you to know that as we close out, this altar is open. If you feel the need to come down and pray, please feel free to do so. We're not going to ask you to show your vaccination card. It's there if you want to come forward and pray. Let's take some time to close out worship. If you feel the need to come down and pray, do so. If not, maybe pray silently where you are for those that are struggling. The altar is open. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us in worship today. If we have your kids in the back, they're hopped up on warm Mountain Dew and Pop-Tarts. Please don't forget to collect them. Kidding. We love you, kids. We're glad to have them. And continue to pray for our children's ministry as it rebuilds. Pray for our youth ministry as it rebuilds after COVID and Hurricane Michael. Pray for the church. Thank you for loving us enough to come and worship with us today. If you're visiting, we extend warm Christian greetings to you and an honor to have you. Stand together and receive this benediction. Move into the world now to be the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ, to be his salt and to be his light. Doesn't matter what the person next to you is doing or not doing. It doesn't matter what your preacher is saying or not saying or doing or not doing. What matters is the relationship that exists between you and Jesus Christ and what you do with it. Show the world what you do with it as you show them his love. Do this with the love of God, with the peace of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit moving you forward. In his name, amen. Thanks for coming.